Good morning, everyone. Look at all these bright and early people. This is awesome. Well, welcome. We are so glad that you've made it today. This is our first time in a while that we're going to begin doing two services. And so we're so glad that you're here today. Welcome, everyone online. My name is Danelle. I'm one of the worship leaders here at Peace Portal. If you have come back from being away over the summer, welcome. If it is your first time here, welcome. We're so glad that you're here. And we are going to begin our time together, as we do each week, in singing songs of praise and worship to our God. So I want to invite you to stand. And before we sing, we want to focus our hearts in our minds on who God is. And so Riley here is going to lead us in a call to worship to remind us of this.
So Christ brought us together through his death on the cross. The cross got us to embrace, bridging the gap of hostility between those who are far from Christ and those who are near. Christ came and preached peace to all of us, treating us as equals and making us equals before him. Through him, we share the same spirit and have equal access to the Father. That's plain enough, isn't it? You're no longer wandering exiles. This kingdom of faith is now your home country. You're no longer strangers or outsiders. You belong here, with as much right to his name, or to the name Christian as anyone. God is building a home. He's using us all, irrespective of how we got here and what he is building. He used the apostles and the prophets as the foundation. And now he's using you, fitting you in brick by brick, stone by stone, with Christ Jesus as the cornerstone that holds all parts together. We see it taking shape day after day, a holy temple built by God. All of us built into a temple in which God is quite at home.
Awesome, thanks Riley. We're gonna sing together, we're gonna worship him. Let's sing this together, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now I see. God's praise. And when we first begun.
I need you to put your hands together for this one. Even move your feet a little. That's okay. so sweet to be together worshiping with you. Before you have a seat, we would invite you to say hello to one or two people that you might not have come in the door with this morning. Do that, and then you can have a seat.
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to Peace Portal. Some of you have been attending church for years. Some of you are checking us out for the very first time in person or online. So welcome. My name's Ann. I'm one of the pastors on the team. If you are here today in person, this is a great Sunday. Welcome. This is kickoff party Sunday. What does that mean? Yeah, thanks. What does that mean? It means that after the service, there is a ton of food for you to enjoy. There are some games for the littles. So plan to stay to join kickoff party. There, you'll see there's a couple of food trucks, coffee and donuts. Those ones are for purchase, but I'll give you more information at the end. So as we're getting into the fall rhythms, there's a variety of ways to get connected. You'll see QR codes around. You can go online and check out all the fall programming. You can fill out a Connect card. You can go to the Connect desk. There's a ton of greeters around that you can ask questions to. The whole point is to get plugged in to this faith community because there's a lot going on. One other thing I wanted to mention, today you're going to notice that there's a lot of little kids in the service, and we will continue to have littles in the service, but you've probably seen this before here at Peace Portal, but going forward from this Sunday onwards, we are encouraging families to bring their kids into the music worship part of our time together. And so what we're asking for families to do is check in your kids. There are check-in stations downstairs and upstairs before you come into the service. Nursery to kindergarten is as usual, but grade ones to grade fours, we're asking for you to join us in the service. And then at a certain point, you're going to be dismissed. But it would be really helpful to have their sticker ready to go. And I wanted to explain just really quickly that typically, we see sometimes that kids are kind of shifted to the side or that they're another department that's like an extra thing. It almost seems like a burden or something that's bothersome. But we know that Jesus said, let the children come to me. We know that he wanted to include, it was inclusive in worshiping him and to encounter his power and his presence. And so we want to be a faith community that encourages that development of children. So they're seeing how worship is modeled. They're seeing the generations coming together and worshiping God. And they're being shown and taught how to love the Lord their God with all their heart, mind, and soul. So it might feel like, oh my gosh, you might see little ones running around. But hey, we're just going to embrace it. We're just going to embrace that we're one big family. And so kids, if you are sitting upstairs, you'll see your teachers that are out in the hall. They are there ready to greet you. You can find your grade, 1, 2, 3, 4. They're ready to go. If you're here on the bottom floor, you can go through the main doors, and we have teachers there ready to go as well. And we will take you upstairs. So let's go.
Awesome. So while the kids are going to their classes, I would want to invite the rest of us to once again stand as you're able, and we're going to sing one more song together. And this song is, it's a newer song. We sang it for the first time together last week. It's called Holy Forever. And in playing this song last week and listening to it, this song reminds me of in Hebrews chapter 13, I believe, it says that Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And throughout the summer, something that I have noticed in just in my life, just the people that I've been walking with, I have found that as I ask questions of people of how is your summer, there's a huge variety of answers that I would get. For many of us, summer has been joyful. It has been life-giving. We found joy in family and relationship, in our communities, in opportunity. But for some in my life that I have found and I have been walking with, is there are people in my life that also haven't had great summers, maybe circumstantially, or kind of just going through their sorrow or loss. And I want to invite us that whether we find ourselves in a joyful season or a season of sorrow or anywhere in between that, I want to invite us to be reminded today that our God is a God who doesn't change even when our circumstances do, even when things in our life might not seem the way it should be. Our God stays the same. He is constant. And this is a song that I would love for us to be reminded of as we sing it together. And so let's sing, let's worship our God, and let's sing of a God who is the Holy One forever, the one who remains the same, who is constant in all things. Let's sing. Sing a thousand generations.
A thousand generations falling down. Your name is the highest, your name
Would you pray with me? Our Father, what an awesome creator you are. We remember the things that we have seen this summer, whether sunsets or ocean views. We remember and we give you thanks. We remember smiling children and friends gathered. We give you thanks for all that is good, Lord. It is from you, the giver of every good gift. And as we gather with the church family at the beginning of a new year of sorts, we also choose to remember what you've done for us. We remember that you sent your Son to lead us out of darkness and into light. We remember that he brought grace and truth to the world, that he brought healing and wholeness. We remember that his love went so far as to die for us, taking the consequence of our sin upon himself. And we remember, all praise to you, that he did not stay dead but rose again in power. It is this resurrection that we are invited into here and now. The deepest experience of new life, of eternal life through union with you. And so we say together, come Holy Spirit, pour out new life on us, your people. Take us on the journey this year of dying to our old selves, all that we are not, and rising to new life in the Spirit, all that we were created to be in Christ. Make us new, Lord. Wash us where we have mired in unforgiveness and stewed in hurt. Heal us where we are broken and wounded. Love us where we have refused love for too long. Unite us where we have been okay, even perpetuated division. Empower us for the things that you have called us to. Mature us, O God, that we might know you better and love you more. We take the opportunity this morning to ask you to bless those returning to work. Let your light shine in them and let them walk in your grace and truth in ways compelling to those around them. Teach us all how to integrate more fully our faith in you and our work. We also bless those returning to or beginning school. God, would you bless them and be present to them? Allow them to be seen by their teachers and to develop good friends quickly. We bless rescue workers in Morocco and those who have lost loved ones. God, would you draw near? Would you continue to rescue? Would you have mercy, Lord? And together we ask you to bless Scott as he returns to us and as he brings your word to us this morning. Let it accomplish the things for which you send it. And we ask that you'd sustain Scott in your love and grace over the year ahead. We all need you, Lord. Hear us say that together this morning. We need you, and our world needs you. So draw near to us as we worship. Draw near to us as we listen to your word. Draw near to us as we seek you this fall. Show us more of who you are, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. You can grab a seat and turn your attention to the screen here.
Hi, everyone. My name is Judy, and here's what you need to know this week. If you're new to Peace Portal and want to connect deeper into the life of the church, there is a lot happening at Peace Portal beyond our Sunday services. Community groups are places of belonging where we practice the way of Jesus together. If you're interested in joining a group, please drop by the Connect Center after the service. Check out this short video to learn more.
It can be hard to connect in deep and meaningful relationships these days. Jesus created the church to be a people so full of love for one another, they could be called family. The church is meant to be an authentic community where belonging, friendships, and a place to grow in faith are found. Community groups are places of belonging where we practice the way of Jesus together. Some of the essential rhythms of Jesus' way are eating together, praying together, learning together, and serving together. These are rhythms every community group engages in as they deepen in relationship with one another and with God. Community groups are meant to be local pockets of the Jesus way. We engage in deep community while also living missionally. Hospitality is a value for us as we open our doors to make our community groups warm and inviting places to one another, and also to our neighbors as we seek to love them and invite them on a journey with Jesus. Join a community group in your neighborhood today.
As we lean into another ministry season here at Peace Portal, we invite you to join us as we set aside time to intentionally pursue God together. Kingdom Come is a space dedicated to worship and prayer as we ask God that His kingdom would come in increasing measure in our church, workplaces, homes, and communities. We invite you to join us on September the 12th at 7 p.m. here in the sanctuary. At Peace Portal, we invite everyone into a deepening relationship with Jesus and full engagement in His mission as we seek to glorify God. Here are three next steps designed to help you do just that, all happening on Sunday, September 24th, after the 11 a.m. service. First, if you're new to Peace Portal or the Christian faith, and you want to learn more about who we are and why we exist, we invite you to Starting Point. Starting Point provides an opportunity for you to connect with others over lunch, and it's designed to help you connect into the life of our church. Second, if you're already a follower of Jesus and want to learn more about baptism and what the important step of publicly declaring your faith is all about, we invite you to join us for a baptism lunch. And third, if Peace Portal is your home and you're ready to commit to being all in as we passionately pursue God together, you're invited to our membership lunch. Together we'll cover a few of the ways in which you can join the ministry at Peace Portal and some of the ways that you can honor God with our time, talent, and treasure. Please register in advance for each of these lunches online at the Connect Center today. That's all you need to know. Have a great week.
Judy McDonald, usually up at the booth there, she's had about 22 jobs and now she's got an announcement job too. Soon she'll be preaching here, which would be amazing. Judy McDonald. She's usually not that jerky in person, so sorry for that video, a little jerky there. Hi, everyone. Great to be here on this kickoff Sunday. Those of you online here, welcome. We're glad you're here. My name is Scott. I serve as the lead pastor at the church, and I just got back last week from a three-month leave to rest and recalibrate myself before we dove into this season of ministry and school together. So it's so good to be here. Let me just give you a brief update, because some of you were here in the spring when I shared a little bit just some of the things I was starting to notice in my own life, some of the warning signs around my own fatigue. And so let me just update you along the way, and then we'll dive into some things. So I did talk to the elders and said, yeah, there's some things that I'm starting to be concerned about in my own life, and I think it's trying to tell me something. And so the elders responded very graciously. We decided we'd gather up my vacation days, all my vacation days, all my sick days, and then we threw on some leave moments in there as well, and I had 3 months to just get away and do some soul care. At the start of my leave, apart from just slow down and rest, at the start of my leave, I also just identified some streams that were flowing into my life that I thought may be contributing to some respect, in some respects, to the fatigue that I was feeling. And I just marked them out and said, I want to explore these and understand to what degree are these things affecting me in ways that I need to deal with and be attentive to. So I did that. I spent some time doing that, and I can tell you that the most significant contributing factor, the thing that needed to be addressed, wasn't, I mentioned things like long COVID in the spring. I have some symptoms there. They're not debilitating, but I explored that. It wasn't necessarily external circumstances and situations that needed to change. The number one most important thing that had to get addressed and resorted and in some senses fixed a little was me. Wah, wah, wah. Would have loved for it to be something else. No, but it was me. It was me. And in particular, how I was processing and navigating my life in the last little while. I'm not going to go into a deep dive here, but I will summarize for you because it's somewhat important and pertinent to what I'm going to say in just a few moments. But I have a tendency to want to manage things and manage outcomes, or some might use the word control. And when I can't control things or can't manage outcomes, I then feel uncomfortable, I feel anxious, or it stresses me out, and therefore I then retreat. I distance myself from that which I can't control. This isn't necessarily a brand new revelation for me, but over the last 3 months, as I took some time to think through it, as I met with a counselor fairly consistently to help me unpack some of this stuff, I did see this dynamic more clearly. I began to appreciate more fully just how it plays itself out in lots of areas of my life, including my work and my parenting and my marriage and even my relationship with God. And this was the major factor that I needed to address over the last little while. Now, again, this isn't meant to be a public therapy session. I'm telling you all this for a couple of reasons. And the first is this. If you're here today and you're at Peace Portal and you don't really know much about our community, or maybe you're here for the first time, or maybe you're here and you've been a long-time attender and you just don't feel like you have it all together, neither do I. Welcome. You're among friends. Peace Portal is a community of people moving towards healing and wholeness because of the grace of Jesus. And so if you're keenly aware that there's still messy parts of your life or places where you still feel undone, you're in actually the right place. You're here in community, and we welcome you here. Second, I'm telling you this because on a walk that Tracy and I had during my leave, somewhat early on during my leave, she really wisely framed the moment for me, the leave moment for me. And I don't remember her exact words, but they were something along the lines of this. Scott, a lot of who you are and how you are is great. It's carried you through the last 30 years of adulthood and the last almost 3 decades of ministry. It's not that it's all bad. There's lots of good. But how you have been is no longer working for the present. And we're in a new phase of life. I am, actually. I'm not sure Tracy's in a new phase of life. I'm in middle age, for sure. I'm not sure she is. I am. Hear me. I'm in middle age. My wife is not. Or she may be, but that's for her to determine. We're in a different stage of life. We've got new ways of being that we need to learn, and I do. And there was some unhealth tripping me up that now God is inviting you to work on. And actually, you've got the space now to do it as well. So it's this invitation to grow. And it was so helpful for me to just have her frame it that way. And I responded to her and chatted with her for a few minutes, and then I said this. I said, it's so interesting that you'd frame it that way, Tracy, because I actually feel like the way you're framing it is the exact place that we as a church are in as well. And it's interesting because before I left for my leave, the pastors and the directors got together and we spent some time praying and processing and discussing, God, what do you want to say to our church in the next season, the fall season? What do you want us to dig into throughout the fall as a church community? And in a bit of an unusual way, I would say, in a uniform sort of way, God directed us, many of us, to the similar main themes and even the same book of the Bible. And the underlying conversation that went on in that room during that those few moments together was that the evangelical church in general, perhaps, us included, is in this season of disorientation. In some ways, we could say that what has worked in the past is not working as well in the future and perhaps won't work as well in the present, or in the future. As our society continues to change at breakneck speed, and our Canadian context becomes increasingly secular, and the values of our society is distinct from the Christian values we hold, many of us don't know how to navigate that tricky reality. As high-profile pastors get exposed for their misuse of power, many people are becoming increasingly disillusioned, even with leadership within the church. As the evangelical church in particular continues to fracture over social and political issues, many of us feel tossed from side to side as supposed experts trumpet their opinions back and forth, and people are increasingly wondering, is there a healthy middle ground that exists anymore? Is there even like a truth that we can be certain of? Seems like everyone's got an opinion and everyone has a counter opinion. What do I even believe? As people, in particular the younger demographic, continue to express that the current structure and experience of church isn't actually drawing them closer to God, it's actually leaving them somewhat empty and disconnected. Many church leaders are naming this need to change into the future, but we can't quite name or articulate what that change might exactly look like. Perhaps more than any other time in the last 50 to 60 years, for sure, I think the people of God, the church in North America, in Canada, in this city, in our context, I think the church is struggling to really understand and know how to embody all that we believe and all that God calls us to. And so we want to dig into that. We want to try to answer that question a little bit over the fall season. As Jeff said just a couple weeks ago, there may be some new wineskins required for the new wine of God's work in the present and into the future. Now, just to be clear, the new wineskin is never a new gospel, right? We know that. This amazing message that Justin actually prayed out for us, that doesn't change. And at present, we could say even, we don't think that the new wineskin includes a new vision or mission for our church. We still believe that we as a church community are called to be a church where every home, wherever they are scattered in this city, every home would be growing disciples and serving our neighbors and sharing Christ. If you're joining the church community, this is the vision that we have. This is what we feel like God's invited us into, and it's what we want to continue to work towards throughout the fall. So that doesn't need to change. What perhaps does need to change is how we embody that together. What perhaps needs to change is get a new vision for what it means to be the church together and a church for our city. Now here's the plot twist. That new vision for what God might be inviting us into, we believe it doesn't come from a soon-to-be next best-selling book or a church leaders conference in California. We actually think it's embedded in this book. We think it's here. It's not related to a new program per se, although structures might change. It's not related to a new social media blitz. It's about a new way of understanding ourselves, understanding our God first, then understanding ourselves in light of what God has done for us in Christ, and then us aligning ourselves to the part that He calls us to play. Some of the most compelling, did you lose me? Am I here? There I am. Okay. Some of the most compelling instruction around what it means for God's people to be His people, the church to be the church, is found in the book of Ephesians, and in particular, Ephesians chapter 4. And we're going to spend the next fall series, up until Advent, unpacking this one chapter. Ephesians chapter 4, in a series entitled No Longer Infants. That series title comes from chapter 4 itself, where Paul in verse 14 says this to the church: "Then we will no longer be infants, tossed back and forth by the waves and blown here and there by every wind of teaching and by the cunning and craftiness of people in their deceitful scheming. That obviously has a context. We'll get into that in about a month and a half. But Paul's assessment of the church in Ephesus is that they needed some grounding. They needed a firm foundation. They needed a vision for what God was asking them to be, how to be together as a church, and then how to be together in that city for the sake of the city. They needed that vision to help them navigate the complexities of their own circumstances, their own city, their own time, their own space. And yet, when I read that verse, I think, oh my goodness, does the evangelical church not feel like it's getting tossed to and fro, and no one knows which end is up? What's a Christian worldview? How can I possibly articulate that and live in that when I'm getting discipled over and over again by Netflix and by YouTube and by college professors? How do we live out God's vision for who he made us to be? That's what we need to figure out first and foremost as a church community. And this morning, I just want to set the series up briefly with you in a way so that you can understand Ephesians chapter 4. And to do that, I will borrow a little bit of time and energy and nice drawing skills from our friends at the Bible Project. So the first half of the book of Ephesians can be summarized on the screen behind you now.
Paul's letter to the Ephesians. The story of how Paul came to the city of Ephesus is really interesting. You can go read about it in Acts chapter 19. Ephesus was a huge city. It was the epicenter of worship for most of the Greek and Roman gods. And for over 2 years, Paul had a really effective missionary presence there, and lots of people became followers of Jesus. Years later, after being imprisoned by the Romans, Paul wrote this letter. The movement of thought in the letter divides into two really clear halves. In the first half, Paul is exploring the story of the gospel, how all history came to its climax in Jesus and in his creation of this multi-ethnic community of his followers. The second half of the letter is linked to the first by the word therefore. And here Paul explores how the gospel story should affect how we live every part of our life story, personally, in our neighborhoods and communities, and in our families. So let's dive in, and we can see how Paul develops all of this. Chapter 1 opens with a beautiful Jewish-style poem where Paul praises God the Father for the amazing things that he has done in Christ Jesus. From eternity past, the Father has purposed to choose and bless a covenant people. And think here, the family of Abraham and Genesis chapter 12, verses 1 through 3. And through Jesus now, anyone can be adopted into that family. Jesus' death covers our worst sins, our worst failures, and in Jesus we find God's grace. In fact, Paul says, that grace has opened up a whole new way for us to understand every part of our lives. He says in chapter 1, verse 10, that God's purpose was to unify all things in heaven and on earth under Christ, which is a title that means Messiah. God's plan was always to have a huge family of restored human beings who are unified in Jesus the Messiah. This divine purpose became clear, Paul says, when we were first made into that family. And here he's referring to ethnic Jews in the family of Abraham. But then Paul talks about how you, and here he means non-Jews, you all heard about Jesus and the salvation through him. And you were also brought into this family by the work of the Holy Spirit. And so here he's referring to the events told in the stories of Acts about how God's Spirit brought together Jew and non-Jew into one family in Jesus. It's just like God promised to Abraham long ago. Notice also how in this poem, Paul begins by talking about God the Father, but then about Jesus the Son, and then here at the end about the Spirit. All three work together as Paul tells the story of the gospel. It's really cool. After the poem, Paul responds with a prayer. He prays that these followers of Jesus would not just know about, but personally experience the power of the gospel, that they would be energized by the same power that raised Jesus from the dead and placed him as the exalted head of the whole world. Now, in chapter 2, Paul goes back and he elaborates on some key ideas from the poem in chapter 1, especially God's grace and this new multi-ethnic family of Jesus. He begins by retelling the story of how these non-Jewish Christians came came to know Jesus. Before hearing about Jesus, they were physically alive, but they were spiritually dead. They were trapped in a purposeless life of selfishness and sin, and they were deceived by dark spiritual forces of evil. But amazingly, God, in his great love and mercy, he saved them, he forgave all of their sins, and he joined their lives to Jesus' resurrection life, and he's brought them back to life too. And so now, having been created as new human beings through Jesus, they have the joy of discovering all of the new calling and purposes and tasks that God has set before them. Not only have they been shown God's grace, they've also been invited into a new family. Before hearing about Jesus, these non-Jewish people, they were not just cut off from God, they were cut off from his covenant people, the family of Abraham. And for a really practical reason, the commands of the Sinai covenant, they formed like a boundary line around the family. They were like a barrier that kept most non-Jewish people away. But in Jesus, the laws of the Torah have been fulfilled and the barrier is removed. The two ethnic groups have become, as Paul puts it, a new unified humanity that can live together in peace. So Paul goes on in chapter 3 to marvel at the unique role that he got to have in spreading this good news to non-Jewish people. And even though he's in prison, he's thanking God for the chance he's had to see this covenant family grow so huge. So Paul closes the first half of the letter with another prayer. This time, he prays that Jesus' followers would be strengthened by God's Spirit to simply grasp and comprehend the love that Christ has for his people.
It's a beautiful three chapters. I'd encourage you this week as we dive into this fall series for you to just spend some time reading through chapters 1 to 3. Paul articulates the gospel in some beautiful ways and what God has done for us. That they mention the word new humans there. That's a really important piece of what we're going to just briefly mention here even this morning. A new way of being, new people with a new way of being, because we have been newly resurrected by the power of the Spirit. And in the second half of Paul's letter, they mentioned it, he transitions from that first part to the second part, the outworking of that reality with this word, therefore. It's a really key part of the text. Another way we might say it is, in light of all of what God has done for us in Christ, he says that in verse 4, chapter 4, verse 1. He says, therefore, as a prisoner for the Lord, I urge you to live a life worthy of the calling that you have received. And for the remainder of the letter, the next three chapters, Paul is going to unpack what that looks like. You are a new humanity created in Christ, gifted the power of the Spirit who is at work in your life. Therefore, live a new way of life. And for the chapter 4, Paul is going to start to say, here's how you do it as a church community, and here's how you as a church community do it in your society. And that's what we're going to be digging into over the next few months. Now, let me just highlight one really important point that could mess up our understanding of the following three chapters of Paul's letters if we don't understand this. Many of us hear this, the words or the sentence, live a life worthy of the calling you have received. And we immediately translate that into something like, in light of what God has done for you, pull up your bootstraps, smarten up, start living a life that proves that you were worthy of being called in the first place. You don't want God to have wasted one of his picks on you. This past week, I took our youngest child, Paisley, to go get her test so that she could move from an L driver to an N driver. It's been a long time since some of you have had kids, or maybe you haven't because you have younger kids, and maybe some of you, it's been a long time. So you wouldn't understand how important this jump is from an L driver to an N driver. But what happens now in BC is this. When your child turns 16, she or he gets an L if they pass a short little test. They get an L, they become an L driver. And what that means for parents is absolutely nothing. because parents are still required to be in the car with their child wherever they drive. So no sending your child out on their merry way so you can continue to do what you were doing, right? No, an L driver, the only thing that changes for parents is that you move from being comfortably in control in the driver's seat to somewhat car sick, and at times pressing your feet into the floor with your heart racing and you're saying a bit too loud, "Braking, they're braking." That's a year. And after a year, you get a chance to go from your L to your N, and there's a test to do it. And if parents don't care about the L test, they care a lot about the N test. So I was a little bit nervous for Paisley. Paisley was a bit nervous because she had plans for the fall and she needed to be able to drive herself places because I couldn't be Ubering around. I have a job now again, so that's a thing. So I'm a little nervous trying to see, which person's going to go to her car, and I hope they look nice, whatever that might mean. And Paisley's nervous, and rightfully so, right? Because a person, a stranger, hops in your car and sits beside you for the next 30 minutes, and their sole purpose of being with you is to judge you and to determine whether you are worthy of holding the N driver's license of British Columbia. That's not what Paul is talking about here. He's not talking about passing a test, proving that you're worthy. And yet, if you were raised in the evangelical church, it might be just so deeply embedded that we just have to measure up. We have to prove ourselves. We have to pass the test. The Greek word that Paul uses here actually is has relationships with two different sort of pictures. One is a balance scale, and it's like balance things up. The other is related to fitting, have it fit properly. And what Paul is really speaking to here is much more profound and much more beautiful and hopeful than measuring up and leading or proving ourselves as worthy. Really, what Paul is saying is live, church, I've just explained for three chapters who you are, who God is, what he's done for you, that you are a new creation in Christ, that you've been gifted with the Spirit. Now, live who you are. That's really all he is saying. Live out who God has already made you to be. This is your new identity. This is your new reality. Live into that. Live into the new spirituality, this spirit-empowered way of being that you are now. You are that. This verse isn't some furrow-browed, come on, shape up or ship out. It's this joy-filled call for us who have been redeemed by God to be the people he redeemed us to be. And make no mistake, we're going to figure this out along the way. It still takes work. It still requires decisions. It's still hard for us to take off the old and put on the new. So we've got to work at it. We've got to put effort into it. It requires our will, but it's motivated by our loving response to God's radical love for us displayed in Christ, and not some effort to try to prove ourselves as worthy. And we can see that just by the way Paul shaped his letter. The first three chapters, it's just, Paul is just playing out such beautiful truths. We've been chosen. Do you know this? Church, if you're a follower of Jesus, you've been chosen by God. You've been forgiven. You've been adopted into his family. You've been given the Holy Spirit to empower and enable your transformation. You've been blessed, Paul says, with every spiritual blessing in Christ. And as Paul rehearses all of these things, by the end of chapter 3, he can't help himself. He breaks out into this prayer for the Ephesian church. And it's a prayer that I want to conclude my time with you praying for us. And it flows out of this beautiful picture that Paul has about what God has really done and the faith-filled expectations about who he can be and who the church can be together if we would just live out who we are. I believe if God was to answer this prayer for all of us as individuals and as a church community, there would be this beautiful transformation taking place right before our eyes as we gather together, as we're in our community groups, as we're in our youth groups and our Bible studies and whatever else as we gather together, there'd be this beautiful transformation of who we are together and then our beautiful turning towards the city that we're in. And so I want to pray this for us as we wrap up, because these are the last words that Paul writes before he jumps to therefore. And so I want to pray them for us. And if you're willing to, I want to invite you to stand with me now. And if this is something you long for, I want to, at minimum, just invite you as I pray to just hear these words and open up your own hearts and give your yes and amen to God quietly as we pray. And if you are so inclined, you want to demonstrate that physically, you might want to just open your hands and say, yes, God, I would love to receive this from you in this season. Let's pray together. For this reason, Peace Portal, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. And I pray that out of his glorious riches that he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, Peace Portal, that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all of the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the measure of the fullness of God. Now, to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And God's church said, amen. Looking forward to going on the journey with you, church, as we unpack this chapter. We're going to conclude our service today by reminding ourselves about the gospel through song. If you're here today and you've carried something in that you're praying about and you want to invite someone else into that conversation, there's going to be people at both sides of our sanctuary. You can see the prayer signs there. You can go during this song and pray with someone, or right after the service concludes, you can pray with someone there. And after that, of course, we invite you to be the church together as we enjoy some time after the service.
beautiful. Oh my goodness. We're going to start our party. You can't sit still when you're talking about a party, Scott. And so, or stand still. I can't, at least. We are going to have our kickoff party. There are activities outside. The food trucks are going. The quiche is ready to go. And so for about 45 minutes or so, we have this all set up. And then we're going to transition the next service. If you came and you thought you were coming for a 10 o'clock service, surprise, we start at 11. 9 and 11, new times. So enjoy the rest of your time here. Remember to connect with somebody that you haven't met or fill out that connect card. Go to the connect desk, ask people. Keyword here is connect with someone. We'd love to see you plugged into this faith community. Be blessed, grace, and peace to you. Amen.
There's honey in the rock, water in the storm, manna on the ground, no matter what.